The advocacy group Access Now says its longest ever internet blackout by a democratic government, the internet in Indian-controlled Kashmir, has now been shut down for almost 150 days. Now, the communications shutdown began in early August when India revoked the special status that granted the region autonomy. Phone service also was shut down but has since been restored. Now, the move cut off 7 million people there in what the government says is an effort to quell unrest. We want to bring in Sadanand Dhume from Washington. He is a resident fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. And I thank you for joining us on a story that perhaps we haven't been able to take a deeper dive in enough, especially now that this has gone on so long, right? The blackout, unprecedented in a democracy. And yet it shows that Mr. Modi here somehow feels emboldened, like he can do this.
You know, this is, I mean, we're talking about the, you know, the blackout, which is in the Kashmir Valley. And now it refers specifically to mobile internet. So in August, what the Indian government did at first was they cut off all phones. Since then, they've restored landlines, but what they have not, and they've restored mobile phones, but what they have not restored is mobile internet. And their argument is that, well, if we restore it, it's going to create a security hazard because militant groups will be able to use it to organize. And I think most people on the other side of the argument, including, you know, human rights groups, say that is preposterous. You don't rob ordinary citizens of the ability to use mobile internet in the age of the smartphone just because you happen to be worried about a handful of terrorists or militants.
But if I can interject here, so then what does he hope to accomplish here? I mean, clearly he believes there is an objective to continuing this for so long now, 150 days.
You know, what's happening is that across India, I mean, I think Kashmir is the most egregious example, but more recently we've seen protests in other parts of the country and they've shut down the internet in other parts of the country too. What you see is that the authorities increasingly resort to this as a sort of knee-jerk response. They feel that wherever there are disturbances, wherever there is sort of organized protest that they fear may get out of hand, that's what they do. That's just a sort of, it's a heavy-handed, quasi-authoritarian approach to protest. Now, in Kashmir specifically, it's, you know, exacerbated by the fact that Mr. Modi and his government have sold their crackdown there as, you know, this great thing which is going to be very good for the people and welcomed by the people. But it's pretty clear that the people of Kashmir are unhappy. And I think they want to stop that word from getting out, not only to the world, but also to the rest of the country.
You know, the last several months, you've written a lot of editorials about where India is going and where the prime minister wants to take his country. Religious pluralism at one time was the bedrock of India's evolution, and you point out even of its economy, right? Do you think Mr. Modi is turning his back on all that? And if you do think that, why?
That's my big worry. You know, I have a piece in the Wall Street Journal on Friday where I make the argument that for decades now, you know, India has projected itself in the world as this beacon of pluralism in a tough neighborhood. And now you have the prime minister in his second term who has decided apparently to double down on his party's Hindu nationalist ideology instead of focusing on the economy. And my argument is that the economy is in fact doing very poorly. It just makes it makes no sense in any case, but it makes even less sense to be picking a fight with India's 175 million Muslims at a time when your economy is in free fall. Unfortunately, that doesn't seem to be how the government sees this in New Delhi.
And so if we bring this full circle back to what's going on in Kashmir, as I said, he seems to be acting with impunity here because the internet crackdown continues. Does that seem likely going into 2020 that it will work? That he has, in fact, quelled unrest there on what would have been a very controversial move at any point in time?
No, so it hasn't been costless for India. I think India has taken a huge reputational knock. That said, Kashmir is a bit of a hidden conflict or a bit of a forgotten conflict. There's so much going on in the world. There's so much turmoil in the world. And I think that, you know, the world really hasn't paid as much attention to this as they should have. So I'm sort of grateful to you for doing this story.
Yeah, and we will continue to follow this, of course, into 2020, as many people are still predicting that Kashmir could, in fact, be a flashpoint. I thank you for your insights. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.